We've been chatting for the last few days on the subject of wisdom, and we're looking at wisdom being the principal thing. And we discussed how, from the book of Proverbs, in the beginning of Solomon's writing, he says in Proverbs chapter number 4 and verse 7 that wisdom is the principal thing, or wisdom is the thing of principles. And then he begins to say that if we begin to ask for wisdom, that God will definitely impart that to our lives. James chapter number 1 verse 5 says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, and God will give to every man that asks. So wisdom then is something that we can pray for. Wisdom is something that we can get, because the Bible says if you'll seek wisdom, it will be given to you. Wisdom is something that is imparted to you through many channels, through schooling, through life, through revelation, and wisdom finally can also be imparted to us through a cluster of individuals or a mentor. The scripture says in chapter number 2, verse 52 of Luke, that Jesus increased in wisdom. So wisdom is something that can grow in our lives. And as we begin to grow in wisdom, and as we begin to increase in wisdom, we then begin to know our assignment, because every person is assigned to someone or assigned to a people. And once we know that assignment through the wisdom that God gives to us, we then can fulfill the purpose of God. The Bible says the beginning of wisdom is the fear, or the respect, the reverence of God. And it's knowing how to approach our mighty God, because we cannot and should not approach God in a frivolous manner. Even though He is our Father, Abba Father, our Daddy, we still have to approach God in a rightful manner. So it is respect for Him. And not fear, but respect and honor for God. And once that begins to happen and continues to happen, we will then begin to nurture a very intimate relationship with God. And then it becomes so much easier to approach God in time of need. Solomon prayed for wisdom, and we'll deal with wisdom and the way Solomon received an impartation of wisdom. But when Solomon prayed for wisdom in 1 Kings 3, when he prayed for wisdom, it was much of his posture and his approach, his reverence, that got his prayer answered, as opposed to his prayer request. God was impressed with his prayer, but God was more impressed with Solomon's approach, his posture. It wasn't with arrogance. It wasn't haughty. It wasn't prideful. He came as a very, very humble person, because he said, I'm the king of a great nation. I'm the king of a mighty people, and I'm going to need help for this wonderful people that are so endowed with destiny. And that approach, that respect and reverence for God, opened the door incredibly for Solomon. So let's talk about wisdom now in terms of how we can apply that to our individual lives. Wisdom is something that can be caught as well as taught. So the first thing, we have to teach wisdom. We have to then teach principles based on who God is, based on life issues, principles on how to improve our lives. And when we teach these basic principles, it adds value and it adds knowledge to our lives. And then that particular knowledge can be converted into applying solutions to problems we have. So wisdom then is basically an application of truths, or an application of knowledge to any problem we have. So when a problem emerges, we then take the knowledge, we take the information, and we package it for each situation. That could be called wisdom. Wisdom is when we face a complex situation like Solomon faced in his first real trial with two women that had babies at the same time, and one slept on her baby. Solomon took the knowledge that he had, and he then applied it to that situation and solved a very complex, almost unsolvable problem. And everybody was so impressed with Solomon's wisdom. But what it actually was he took knowledge and information he already had and packaged it for that particular situation. So when God gives you wisdom, he gives us knowledge or understanding, how to package that knowledge and understanding applied to a situation we're facing. So let's look at a definition here for wisdom. Wisdom, then, is not something that just can be taught or caught. Wisdom is the issue where we can apply the God-given gift of heavenly information, of heavenly revelation, and make it palatable to any group, any culture, any people, in any time, and in any place. And once that knowledge is then received from heaven or from God, and we then make it palatable for any people, at any time, in any place, that then is called wisdom. So we see the wisdom of Jesus applied in his dealing with all kinds of people groups. He dealt with the scribes, he dealt with the Pharisees, he dealt with the Sadducees, he dealt with people that were on the lower social strata, he dealt with the politicians, he dealt with the tax collectors that were wealthy, such as Zacchaeus. He dealt with 12 apostles that had different temperaments. He dealt with individuals like the Syrophoenician woman that had no access directly into the covenant of God, but he used phenomenal wisdom in dealing with that. He dealt with lepers. He dealt with people that loved him, like Martha and Mary, in Lazarus' situation. He dealt with individuals such as a woman that wept on his feet with her tears, washed them and wiped his feet with her hair. And the men around the room said if Jesus knew what kind of a woman this was, because she was a prostitute, he would not allow this woman to even touch him. But he had a way of dealing with individuals such as those. In a situation where a group came and said this woman was caught in the act of adultery, Moses demands that she should be stoned. You look at the wisdom of Jesus in dealing with a very volatile, very explosive situation. The wisdom that he applies there is pretty phenomenal when he says, he that is without sin cast the first stone, and then instructs the woman what to do. Even in Jesus' temptation, and there were three of those that came in Luke chapter number 4 and Matthew chapter number 4, the first 11 verses of each chapter, in Jesus dealing with Lucifer. The wisdom that he exercises and releases there is pretty mind-boggling. And so wisdom then comes from God, from heaven, and it then is applied to any situation we have at any given moment. Because you can say something in a particular way, and what you say can be right, but the tone and the approach to which you say it can actually turn people off. And even Jesus, while he was tried by Pontius Pilate and of course the Sanhedrin led by Caiaphas and Herod in that horrific passion day before his crucifixion, the wisdom that Jesus releases there with all the groups that he had interaction with or dealings with in that very, very tough few minutes of the last part of his physical life on earth, the wisdom that he applies in all those is totally amazing. And even when he's dying on the cross and he addresses his words to a thief on the cross next to him, and also his words he directs to John and his mother at the foot of the cross, all of those are words that are packed with wisdom. It's uncanny wisdom that comes and can only come from God. The Bible says in chapter number 11, verse 2 of the book of Isaiah, that Jesus received the spirit of wisdom. So it's one thing to have the gift of wisdom. It's another thing to be embraced and to encompass the spirit of wisdom. And so I'm praying that wisdom, the principal thing in your life, will be given to you and imparted to you. One of my favorite apologists is Dr. Zachariah Ravi. And he has a tremendous ministry around the world. And he shares an interesting story of a young man from Vietnam that he had dealings with about 30 or 40 years ago, and how this young man was in a very difficult situation in a prison camp as a prisoner of war, and how God began to deal with him, and during his toilet chores found the book of Romans every single day while he was cleaning the toilet, because the commandant of the camp was using the Book of Romans for his toilet paper. And you can actually Google this on Dr. Ravi Zacharias, and you'll find this particular event. But he begins to say how the wisdom of God, in a very unusual way, was imparted to this prisoner of war who has become a world-renowned minister. The Bible says the wisdom of God is released through babes, through children, because sometimes God can use very simple things to reveal very profound things. That's why wisdom's the principal thing. The very complex formulas that made the world, the laws that govern the world, the structures of life that govern our lives, all of those are founded in different editions and structures of wisdom. And so pray for wisdom. Whoever you are and wherever you are, pray for wisdom. Pray that God would give you wisdom and that God would add wisdom to your life. Finally, as we begin to come to a close on this one, we begin to presuppose the actions of God in our lives. And many times when we go through challenging moments or deep trials or tests, sometimes the loss of a loved one, sometimes maybe a sickness that's not explained, maybe we've lost a job or we've lost an investment, maybe we're going through a personal trauma in our lives, we then begin to question God. But when you have the kind of wisdom that we're talking about, that Solomon encourages us to seek, and that Jesus displayed, the kind of wisdom that James encouraged us to look for, the wisdom that Paul said to Timothy and to Titus, his spiritual sons, that they ought to seek for, when you begin to apply that kind of wisdom to your life, you begin to understand that the entire part of our lives is part of a major plan that God has for us. And so we then ask God for wisdom. We hear the voice of God. The Bible says in chapter number 1 and verse 5 of the book of Proverbs, says, a wise man will hear, a wise man will hear and will increase in learning. And so we open our ear to hear the wisdom of God, and we then apply that to our lives. We open our ear to hear the wisdom of God, and we apply it to the lives of those that are immediately around us. We receive the wisdom of God, and we apply that wisdom to those that we minister to, in my case, to people around the world. We take that wisdom, we make it palatable for people around us. And so when we begin to receive this wisdom in a very, very significant way, we then look at what Peter said in 2 Peter chapter number 1, verse 6 through 7. He says, giving all diligence, and add to your faith virtue, and add to your virtue knowledge, and to your knowledge temperance, which means now that the knowledge that comes from God is something that is constantly added to. It's added to, and we add that to our lives. Proverbs chapter number 1, verse 7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of our knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. And so wisdom is coming to every person here that seeks it. Wisdom is coming to every person here that wants to apply it. Because when God gives us that wisdom then must be used. So sisters and brothers, all of you that are listening to this presentation, wisdom is crying out to you. Proverbs chapter number 1 and verse 20, wisdom is crying out to you. She is forcing her voice in the streets and saying, come and I will give to you and impart to you, because it's available to whosoever will. God knows that in this day and age, more than any time in history, we need the wisdom of God in the lives of people. So I pray for you that you receive wisdom. I'm Bishop Tudor Bismark from Harare, Zimbabwe. God bless you in your quest and in your pursuit for wisdom.